Good evening, everybody, and thank you and welcome to the regular board meeting of Vallecitos Water District on Wednesday, October 5th, 2016. Director Hernandez, will you please lead us in the pledge?
I'd be happy to. Ready to begin?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Jim.
Diane, can we have a roll call, please?
Director Alfar?
Here.
Director Evans?
Here.
Director Hernandez?
Here.
Director Martin?
Here.
Here. And I'll entertain a motion to adopt tonight's agenda.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Okay. We're here for oral communications. Can you guys hear me? Is this on? Can you guys hear me? Say yes or?
No.
No? Can we adjust this a little bit?
I think, did you turn the knob on the side?
Just don't.
That's the speaker.
Oh.
Yeah, so you can hear.
While they're doing that, persons wishing to address a matter not on the agenda may be heard at this time. However, no action will be taken until the matter is placed on a future agenda in accordance to board policy. Public comments are limited to 3 minutes. A request to speaker form, which are located right over there, is required and to be submitted to Diane, right over here, the executive secretary, prior to the start of the meeting, if possible. Public comments should start by stating your name, address, and topic, and the board is not permitted during this time to enter into dialogue with the speaker. And I do have one speaker for oral communication, Michael Hunsaker.
Mike Hunsaker, 115 Equestrian Court. I want to again thank the board for postponing this consideration until now, until to allow people who wanted to attend the Twin Oaks Valley Sponsor Group to attend. I had hoped that it wouldn't appear on the agenda as first action item, because that has the effect of eliminating a number of citizens who thought that that would be covered right at the beginning of the meeting. It should have been at the end at least, and perhaps noting that a break might be taken so that people who are here later can speak and hear what is going on. Also, I have just heard that Governor Brown is thinking of reimposing his water restrictions in San Diego. These, as you remember, are 26%, and none of the water agencies in San Diego really did much to protect and support its ratepayers. I'm hoping in the future we see much more aggressive action. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to the consent calendar. All matters listed under the consent calendar will be voted upon by one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a board member or member of the public requests that a particular item or items be removed from the consent calendar, in which case it will be considered separately under action items. Is there a motion to approve the consent calendar?
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Thank you. Okay, we'll start off with item 2.1, the revised water supply assessment, and I'll turn it over to staff.
As some of you know, I live in close proximity to this development. I don't believe it's of real detriment. I've had some casual inquiries, but in the last 2 days, I've received a letter asking me to see if I have FPC approval to vote or not to vote. So I will take the advice of our legal attorney, and at this point I need to recuse myself from listening to the hearing or voting on it. I'm hoping to get an answer back in a month or two, so I'll be involved because there are many issues revolving this project if it does move forward, and I'm disappointed I can't be a part of it at this time.
And just to add that she's spoken to me, and given the circumstances and the letter and the allegations, I think that out of abundance of caution for each of you as elected officials, that the smartest approach is to get some guidance from the FPPC, and that's what I would advise any of you. Because the consequences, if you don't, and they feel that you have violated it, are pretty serious.
Tom, did you want to take us off, or you just have Rob?
Rob? Thank you there. Good afternoon, President Snell and members of the board. Here to present to you the Newland Sierra Water Supply Assessment and Verification Reports. Just to start off here, give you a little bit of background regarding the Newland Sierra proposed development here. 1,985 acres just west of I-15 and north of Deer Springs Road. It's proposing approximately 1,137 single-family dwelling units, approximately 998 multifamily dwelling units. It also has commercial, it has land for a charter school, approximately 36 acres for a park site, and it's also proposing approximately 1,209 open space acres as well. So this water supply assessment and verification report there, it's meant there to comply with two state Senate bills there, Senate Bill 610 and 221 there, which were approved January 1, 2002. Basically, Senate Bill 610 requires that any public water purveyor that provides over 3,000 acre feet of water a year prepare a water supply assessment for certain proposed projects, and these proposed projects are ones that use an equivalent of 500 dwelling units or greater for the entire developments. And then Senate Bill 221 requires a verification from the water provider that sufficient water supplies are available to serve the developments. On October 20th, 2015, just to give you a little bit of history, the County of San Diego requested that the district complete a water supply assessment and verification reports for the Newland Sierra development. This was approved by the board on January 6th, earlier this year. And then on June 27, 2016, there, the County of San Diego let the district know that there were some minor land use changes for the Newland Sierra project here, and asked that we revise the water supply assessment verification report to include these. And just to give you a comparison here, you have two tables in front of you. So the top table here is, this is what is projected here in the San Diego County's 2011 general plan update here. And this is the area of the Newland Sierra project here, the 1,985 acres. You see they're proposing it predominantly rural or semi-rural residential there with a little bit of commercial and office professional. And applying our duty factors that the board just adopted at the last board meeting, we have assumed here a demand of 1.63 million gallons per day for the project area prior to developments. And then the bottom graph there is showing with the actual Newland Sierra's proposed developments, they would actually use less water. They would use 1.45 million gallons per day. Thus, the project would use approximately 180,000 gallons per day less than what was estimated in the county's 2011 general plan update, or approximately 11% less than what was in the county's general plan update. So the projected demands for the Newland Sierra project, they have been considered both in the Vallecitos Water District and also the San Diego County Water Authority's urban water management plans. The New Lucier project also proposes conservation measures up to an additional 26%, which would actually bring their demands down to approximately 1.07 billion gallons per day. And this would help the district meet its water conservation targets to meet future demands. And so no water shortages are anticipated in the Vallecitos' service area over a 20-year planning horizon, provided that Metropolitan, the San Diego County Water Authority, and the Vallecitos Water District supplies are developed as plans. So with that there, staff recommends approval of the revised water supply assessment and verification report for the new NCR specific plan. And I know we have a presentation there being proposed by the developer. I know we're gonna have probably some public comment as well, but before we get to that, I'd love to answer any questions that the board has on this presentation.
Director Martin?
Didn't we see this once already prior to the revised? Can you tell me the date and if the secretary could tell me what the vote was on it, I'd be appreciative to know.
The initial water supply assessment and verification report that was approved by the board there, January 6, 2016.
And that was approved?
Yes, sir.
Can you get the information? I'd be interested to know the vote.
Director Alcart.
Now, Robert, what were the minor land use and water demand updates that that prompted the county to ask for a revised assessment?
There were minor adjustments there between the residential and the park acreages for the proposed developments. I believe a little bit of park acreage was added, and I think a little bit of residential was kind of adjusted accordingly. We're talking in the terms of about 3 to 4 acres, somewhere in that vicinity.
Okay, thank you. Director Hernandez?
And do I remember that we allocate water usage for open space even though there may not be any irrigation to that California native open space?
That's absolutely correct. We do allocate 200 gallons per day per acre towards open space there. We do have open space accounts that do utilize water. And so when you average the total open space we have in the district with their demand, it comes out to approximately 200 gallons per day per acre. So we have assigned that for the 1,209 acres of open space for the proposed new listed developments.
So that's a real reduction of the 107 down to 105?
I think that's one of the arguments here that the developer is making. We tended not to make that argument there because we do a one-for-one acreage here. So if you have 1,985 acres that we've assumed a certain land use for, we want to make sure that's out.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any questions at this time? Okay. Does that conclude?
That concludes my presentation.
Thank you, yes, sir. Eric Armstrong?
Could you introduce yourself, Eric, and
yes,
anybody that you represent?
Yes, President Sinella, members of the board. My name is Eric Armstrong with Cusco Engineering. I'm a professional engineer, and I've been retained by Newland Communities to prepare engineering plans and work on the Newland CR project. Thanks for having me here today. I've been coordinating with your staff and have been the contact for HDR, the firm retained by DWD to prepare the water supply assessment and verification. And I've been able to answer questions regarding the minor land use changes and the resulting water demand updates for them. I've also coordinated with John Porcello, principal at GSI Water Solutions, Inc. Mr. Porcello and his firm prepared the technical memorandum studying the water conservation demand savings associated with the Newland Sierra project. John could not be here this evening due to a calendar conflict, so I've provided you with a copy of GSI's technical memorandum. This technical memorandum was prepared to provide and provided to HDR for their analysis in completing the water supply assessment verification update for the Newland Sierra project. Recognizing California's water shortages, Inland Sierra is proposing water conservation measures resulting in water savings for its project, which will make it one of the most water-efficient plant communities in Southern California. Inland Sierra is making this commitment, one, in recognition of California's water challenges, two, in response to drought conditions, and three, consistent with the Vallecitos Water District's emphasis on water conservation in its 2015 Urban Water Management Plan. This slide highlights the fact that current water conservation regulatory measures consist of a series of state and local green building and irrigation standards that reduce indoor and outdoor water uses significantly compared with past requirements. For example, based on a report by the California Home Building Foundation prepared in January 2010, a new three-bedroom single-family home in California with four occupants uses 38% less indoor water than a similar-sized home built in 2005, and more than 50% less than a home built in 1980. The California Home Building Foundation report is referenced in the Newland Sierra WSAMB on page 5, footnote number 1. Also, the GSI technical provides a detailed description of these new state and local regulatory water measures. That description can be found in section 2.0 of the GSI memorandum. We have reviewed the HDR's water supply assessment verification report shown here. We concur with HDR's analysis, findings, and conclusions. And those key findings and conclusions were already highlighted by staff's presentation, so we won't repeat them here. The purpose for GSI's technical memo was to calculate and substantiate the reductions in water usage compared with the current water demand forecast that can be achieved for the project by implementing current indoor and outdoor water conservation measures required by state and local law regulations and the water conservation plans and programs of the San Diego County Water Authority, Vallecitos Water District, as outlined in their urban water management plans. Once again, we provided copies of this GSI technical memo to HDR, your staff, and the board, and we also previously provided the GSI technical memo to Golden Door Properties LLC's legal counsel. GSI's technical memo will be used in the county's draft environmental impact report. GSI's technical analysis also substantiates the water savings that can be achieved in the project's design of new buildings, landscape, and other infrastructure that will be constructed as Newland Sierra planned community is developed over time. These water savings will reduce the water demands below the demands estimated in HDR's updated WSAMB. GSI's technical memo includes the analysis of the water savings that can be achieved in the project by implementing current regulatory water conservation measures for indoor water uses in single-family, multifamily residential homes and non-residential facilities, and outdoor water uses that include landscape irrigation and non-landscape outdoor uses in public and private spaces, which are primarily swimming pools. The GSI's water conservation findings are summarized in the executive summary on page 1 and in section 6.0 on pages 18 and 19. In summary, compared with the WSAMB's projected water demand estimate of 1,450,160 gallons per day, with the imposition of water conservation regulatory requirements, the project's water demand will be reduced by 26%. By implementing required water conservation measures, the project's total water demand would be reduced to 1,068,220 gallons per day through water conservation alone. This slide shows an excerpt taken from the County of San Diego's Water Efficiency Landscape Design Manual. Based on this reference, the county prohibits irrigation of native landscaping in open space zones within projects. The Newland Sierra specific plan will also include a prohibition on irrigation within the project's open space preserve and its zone 2 fuel modification areas. This prohibition is consistent with the Wildlife Agency's MSCP preserve planning. For this reason, the GSI technical memo, am I talking? Oh, I'm sorry.
I'll move closer. For these reasons, the GSI technical memo takes into account the elimination of the project's water demand from irrigation and open space and non-irrigated fuel management zone. The GSI eliminated from the project's water demand irrigation water and open space and non-irrigated fuel management zones precisely because of these bio-related provisions. By taking into account the elimination of the project's water demand from irrigation and open space and non-irrigated fuel management zones, the GSI technical memo substantiates that the project's water demand will be reduced by approximately 46% when compared to the WSA&V's project water demand estimate. In summary, by accounting for these additional open space water reductions, the project's water demand would be further reduced to 776,980 gallons per day. To help illustrate that, we put together some graphs. The brown bar shown on this slide graphically depicts the project's total water demand under the WSA&V. The purple bar shows the reduction in the project's total water demand by imposing just the regulatory water conservation measures described in the GSI technical memo. Finally, the blue bar further depicts the reduction in the project's total water demand by eliminating irrigation in the project's open spaces and non-irrigated fuel management zones. This next slide shows the very same project water demands broken down by indoor and outdoor water demand. We did this to illustrate that the GSI technical memo approached the calculation in this way by breaking down the project's indoor and outdoor water demands for their calculations and then combining them back to create the totals. This slide graphically depicts the reductions in the project's water demand when compared to the WSA&V, specifically through water conservation. The purple bar shows that the project can achieve a 26% reduction of water demand when compared to the WSA&V. And by eliminating irrigation in the open space and non-irrigated fuel management zones, the blue bar shows the project can achieve a 46% reduction in water demand compared to the WSA&V. This last slide shows that, as reflected in WSA&V, the brown bar water demand will be 11% lower than the water demand already projected for the same project area based on the county's general plan. Using conservation measures described by the GSI, the purple bar shows the project's demands will be 35% lower than the water demand already projected for this same project area in the county's general plan. Finally, by eliminating irrigation in the project's open space and non-irrigated fuel management zone, the blue bar shows that the project's water demand will be 52% lower than the demand already projected for the same project area in the county's general plan. In conclusion, the GSI technical memo demonstrates that through water conservation efforts, the Newland Sierra project will be one of the most efficient planned communities in San Diego County. HDR's water supply assessment verification also documents the projected water demands for the district and the project area. Based on that data, HDR has determined that there is a sufficient supply over a 20-year planning horizon to meet the projected demand of the Newland Sierra project and the existing and planned development projects within the district service area. For these reasons, we respectfully ask that the board follow its staff recommendation and approve the water supply assessment verification update for this project. If there's any questions that come up in the subsequent presentation, we would like an opportunity to respond to those. And if there's any questions right now, I could answer those for you as well.
Thank you, Eric. Is there any questions at this point? Thank you for your presentation.
Okay, thank you.
If you could, yeah.
Thank you. The motion was made by Director Marvin, seconded by Director Hernandez, and carried unanimously with Director Evans and his panel absent to approve the water supply assessment and verification report for the Newland Sierra district.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we'll move on with the next presentation that we have. Tom Kumura.
I don't have a presentation. I'm just
speaking? Is that?
Oh, I'm sorry. Then I must have been mistaken. Chris Garrett.
No, he wants to say something.
No, I know, but I want to. There is a formal presentation coming up, so. Sorry, Tom. We'll definitely get to you.
No,
I got a lot of these little sheets up here.
Great. This is sort of an organized presentation for the Golden Door.
Mm-hmm.
And there'll be three of us speaking, and as I told your council, we'll make it under 15 minutes.
Thank you.
And it'll be me speaking first on a few overview matters, and then secondly, Mr. Cliff Williams from our office, who's a land use analyst. He previously worked for the city of San Diego doing water analysis issues. And then my associate, Andrew Yancey, will bring up the rear, and we will finish within 15 minutes or less. I did want to thank your staff very much. We really appreciate the courtesy and cooperation.
Hey, Chris, can you just introduce yourself, too?
Sure. My name's Chris Garrett. I work at the law firm of Latham & Watkins, and we've been representing the Golden Door. As some of you may remember, we did appear when the district approved the original water supply assessment, water supply verification, back in January. So we remember that. And since that time, we've been working with your staff. We really appreciate the courtesy and cooperation from your staff and your council. We realize that this is a difficult position for them, and they have listened very carefully to what we submitted. We submitted a very large letter in August. We knew that the matter was going to be postponed, but we still wanted to get our information to them so they'd have as much as time as possible to consider it. I basically wanted to make two points. First of all, what's changed since January? Well, you just heard the presentation from Newland's engineer talking about a new report that we got a copy of yesterday, I guess maybe Monday, from GSI. And that's new. And it sounds like Newland is saying that the water demand factors that are used in the WSA, WSV are wrong. They think they exaggerate the water usage from Newland. So that's new from January. Another thing that's new is you adopted the Urban Water Management Plan in the 2015 one this year, and it has new factors showing supply and demand in the prior year. So we changed our comments to address what we think is the most recent forecast from the district of where things are headed. And the other thing that's new since you were here in January is that last month you adopted the water demand factors. And that really leads me to my last point, which is we sort of have a conceptual frame shift difference, I think, from the applicant, and the applicant has put you into the position where you are not only approving a water supply assessment, which is an advisory document to the county, but you're approving the final water supply verification, which is required for their subdivision map approval, which is the verification that the water actually exists and will exist out into the future for the 6,000 new people that will live in these residential units. You only have to do a verification where we're dealing with residential units. The county doesn't require a verification for new agricultural uses. So it matters that you're putting new residential units out there that were never planned for before, whether or not there was a prior forecast for agricultural water usage there. That's really the concept of our point. And we feel that since your district is the only district, as far as we can tell, out of the 411 urban water management districts around the state, which shows a deficit for every planning year out to 2040 between supply and demand in your water supply, your urban water management plan. Because of that deficit, you're not in the position to approve new large-scale residential projects until you do something to go back and address that deficit. Now, your urban water management plan was put together using the demand factors that you've adopted. The urban water management plan has a demand and supply, and it shows a deficit every year, a substantial deficit, not just a few acre feet each year. And what the district should do, if you're going to follow the approach that's in the water supply assessment and water supply verification, is go back and amend the water demand factors. Look district-wide, maybe the water usage you've estimated is way too high. We don't think it is, we think it's accurate. You said it was accurate last month. Amend that, and then amend the urban water management plan so you don't show a deficit anymore. But while you show a deficit, you can't approve new large-scale residential projects that require verifications. Even if that particular project is pretty wise with its water usage. As long as it's a net burden to your district here, you've got to show that you have a surplus. Every other district in the state shows that. There has never been a water supply verification approved in the state of California that we can find where there has been a, for large-scale residential development, where the district has shown a substantial deficit for every year of your planning forecast and the most recently adopted water management plan. So again, maybe those numbers are wrong, but the way to address that is to tell the district, all the ratepayers, including my client, what the conservation measures will be, how you'll get that demand level lower, and then bring them into balance before you approve the verification. I noticed that Director Elitharp has, and I don't know if you're pronouncing, I'm pronouncing your name correctly.
Pretty close.
You just recently retired from the Rancho California Water District, which I know pretty well. And their urban water management plan shows, doesn't show a deficit for normal years, doesn't show a deficit for dry years or multiple dry years. And if they were going to be approving a water supply verification, I would say the same thing to them if they showed a deficit in their normal year. And the way this, your document here that you're adopting tonight or being asked to adopt, deals with that is to say, well, we'll conserve some more. That may be the way to go, but you can't just leave that indefinite. And I think that's caused a number of people, including my client, to be concerned. Until we know what those conservation measures are, and you formally adopt them and put them in your plan, you can't really rely upon them to close that gap. So that's the difference. You've got these new reports to deal with. You've got this substantial deficit. You've got the precedent-setting nature of things. You've got the fact that Newland hasn't only asked for a water supply assessment, which is an advisory document. They've asked for the verification, which has specific requirements under the government code. You're the last people to sign off on that. And when the legislature adopted that law, the idea was that you would verify that the water was in hand, not that you could get it maybe aspirationally through new measures. I'm going to turn things over to Mr. Williams.
Quick question.
Sure.
Mr. Garrett, and I'm sorry, it took me a while looking at you and looking at your presentation, and you were so good at it, it reminded me, I couldn't think of, now I'm terrible at names, but I remember your face about 20 years ago. I think you were at the city council and you were recommending approval of San Leo Hills. Has that been you and your firm?
I was involved with that. I also represent San Leo Hills, working with the city of San Marcos in the lawsuit against the county on the landfill.
Yeah.
I was the guy that handled the lawsuit where the landfill got closed down. So I was very happy about that.
You did a great job. Thank you.
I also worked with your staff on the Poseidon project. It has been a client of mine for a long time. And first time I was at Vallecitos were many meetings with your general counsel. I think without your staff and your counsel, I'm not sure that project would exist today.
Yeah. Great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, directors. My name is Cliff Williams. I'm a land use analyst at Latham & Watkins. Sort of a unique position. I am not a lawyer at Latham & Watkins, but I serve in a sort of a policy analyst role. I come from that, from the city of San Diego. I was the chief of staff to the San Diego City Council president and also served as the committee consultant for the Natural Resources Committee at the city, which worked on water and sewer issues there. And I worked with the County Water Authority and the city's 10 on the Water Authority Board to move forward the policy agenda of the city at the Water Authority. And you have, this was delivered to you today, a memo from me that analyzes the water supply assessment. And I'm just gonna kind of break down a few of the key points in that. Your secretary has hard copies out of that as well. One of the key points that's really important here that Mr. Garrett was pointing out is that Vallecitos is very unique in that you project a deficit in normal years. So you begin in a deficit. And that's for all of the planned land uses that you have within the growth projections for the Vallecitos Water District that's in SANDAG's 2050 water projections. So the problem is that if you start in a deficit, you can't create something new and say that you're not going to be in that deficit, because if you have a deficit, you can't find that you have adequate water. And that's what Mr. Garrett was saying. You can't verify that you have that water in your planning documents if your planning documents already start you in that deficit. And again, as Mr. Garrett said, the only water agency that we can find that has that deficit is the Vallecitos Water District. And I provided a CD that has that information on it. There's a website that you can actually go to. The Department of Water Resources has all the urban water management plans for all the districts throughout California and parses out the different data there. One of the problems, too, that we saw that when we were trying to match this up is that Your urban water management plan provides demand factors and demand that's actually different than what the County Water Authority says is going to be your demand. And if you look at the County Water Authority's demand factors, it actually gets worse. So we're not sure if you're actually in a worse position, and that's really important because, as you know, up until recently with the desal water that Vallecitos was receiving, virtually 100% of your water comes from the County Water Authority. So that water is, that demand factor is what they are using to determine what your supplies are gonna be. In the Vallecitos Water Urban Water Management Plan, it states that water demands in 2020 in a normal year will be 21,219 acre feet, and the County Water Authority has BWD at 15,896 acre feet. So it's a 5,000 acre foot difference that if you look at the conservation that's required by your plan, it's about a 35-36% reduction in supply that will be created by conservation. If you use the CWA number, you get into the 51%. So it's a very, very significant amount. That 51% would even surpass the 46% that Newland is saying that they can conserve and get to. You're also, as I noted, your urban water management plan notes that you need a 35% conservation to create the supply to fill that demand gap. The problem is that the water code doesn't allow conservation as supply. It says that if you find that there isn't enough water, which your urban water management plan says district-wide, you have to go out and find that water. You have to tell the city or county in your document how you're going to acquire that water. It doesn't say that you can conserve that water, and it's very specific if you look at the water code section 10.19.10. The other thing, too, that was concerning about the water supply assessment is that it looks to this GSI report and it looks to some other reports, Dexter Wilson report, that the water supply conservation will go down. It talks about things like gray water systems. Gray water systems are a wonderful thing, but unfortunately they're very hard to permit. They're hard to actually get online, and there are no large subdivisions that have gray water systems that are actually being used. Yet the water supply assessment seems to say that Newland is going to plumb all of its homes for gray water and is going to use gray water as an irrigation system. It's very hard because you need Department of Health permits for these. You need plumbing code permits. All of your irrigation has to be subsurface. It's a very, very difficult system to implement. I actually worked with a guy that was trying to implement these systems. The only systems we could ever find were out in Rancho Santa Fe, and they were for irrigating large palm trees. So, but the conservation aspects of the of their plan say that these are going to be implemented. The other problem is that you have no land use authority. You can't actually condition the project to do these water conservation measures. So the problem is that you will, if you rely on the conservation measures that they're talking about, you have no power to enforce those. You're going to have to hope that the county does. And if the county wants to do them, they can. If they don't want to do them, they don't have to. But if you've already approved a water supply assessment that assumes these water conservation measures to get you to that 35% reduction, the Vallecitos Water District is out of luck. One way that you actually could create water, and it's something that's been done recently, Lilac Hills has included in their water supply assessment that they will be building a reclaimed water treatment plant as part of the project and a distribution system, or they will expand the Lower Busa reclaimed water treatment plant. So that is something that you could make this contingent upon. Also the Civita project in San Diego in the Mission Valley area is required to build a reclaimed water plant as well. So we have serious concerns about the way that your urban water management plan matches up with the San Diego County Water Authority's plan, that the fact that you need a 35% reduction in using conservation to get you there. And if you talk about that 35% reduction, you're starting almost at your drought level 3 that's in your drought ordinance 162. So, and in that drought level 3, that's the you know, drought condition kind of red, you don't allow any new potable water connections. So if you're starting at a situation in a normal year where you have a 35% reduction that's required to meet your demands, you are almost at that level where you you can't permit new potable connections. And you're pledging for your water district and for all of the existing customers that they're going to have to get there and they're going to have to reduce and basically reduce their demands and live in a perpetual drought cycle. And that's something that you're going to have to decide if that's something you want your water district to have to live with. So I'm going to move on to Andrew Yancey from our office that we'll finish up.
Thank you, Cliff.
Thank you very much, Honorable Directors, staff, council. As Mr. Williams said, I'm Andrew Yancey with Latham & Watkins, representing the Golden Door, world-class spa and resort in Vallecitos, customer in District 1. I want to just hit a few discrete items for you. As you know, we've submitted substantial comments for your consideration in this water supply assessment approval. The first thing I want to talk about is in the urban water management plan, as you've heard, on a district-wide level, projecting out every year from 2020 to 2035, in every scenario, normal year, dry year, multiple dry year, the urban water management plan shows a deficit, a fairly substantial supply deficit in some years. So this is something we raised in our letter that we submitted in August. And when we saw the water supply assessment and verification come out, we wanted to see how that would be addressed on a district-wide level. So what happened was the water supply assessment and verification has applied this new metric. It's not just supply and demand anymore. They added an additional line that's conservation required. Now, this conservation required, it's not in the urban water management plan. It's nowhere to be found. There's a specific number assigned in every single year in the water supply assessment, but it's just not in the urban water management plan. It completely contradicts it. Just for an example, in the year 2020, in a normal year, the water supply assessment says there will be 11,447 acre feet of conservation required. Now, how'd they get there? Well, there's no analysis of specific measures that say this measure will conserve, you know, X amount and this measure will conserve Y amount. What happened was they just looked at the deficit between supply and demand in each one of those years, and they took that number, the deficit, and just called it conservation required so that it made up the difference between supply and demand. Now, that's not an empirical analysis showing that this conservation is actually feasible. That's just making a spreadsheet balance. In addition, moving on to the next point I want to make, there's been some discussion about the water duty factors and how they apply here. If you recall, we were here a couple weeks ago when you approved the water duty factors, and these were the ones that were used in the urban water management plan. And the premise of this water supply assessment verification is that if you apply those water duty factors and you look at existing zoning, it comes up with a certain number. And then if you look at the proposed project, it comes up with another number, and the number for the proposed project is lower. We've had discussions about this in January. We had discussions about it 2 weeks ago. Well, now we're hearing from the project applicant that maybe those aren't right. Maybe there's 200 gallons per acre assigned to open space isn't correct, and they're going through showing all the ways that they're going to do better than the water demand factors. But those water duty factors were approved here, and they have to be used. And if they want to talk about reality of what's really going on, and they're saying, oh, well, we're going to be able to conserve X amount, well, if we're going to look at reality, we need to look at the reality at the property right now. There is little to no water use out there right now. There may have been agricultural proposals in the past, but there's nothing going on. So I just want to point out that you're getting conflicting information. Some people are trying to talk about reality. Some people are trying to talk about the water duty factors. It's a jumble of information that really needs to be cleared up before you can approve something saying you know there's going to be enough supply for this project. My final point is also on a project-specific basis, looking at the specific Newland project. As we discussed, the approach in the water supply assessment, if you look at existing zoning and it says there's more water for existing zoning projected than is projected for the project with its land uses. Well, as we discussed, we take some issues with that, and we take some issues with these conservation requirements. But even if you assume that all of those things right, even if you take everything on the water supply assessment verification at face value, it still shows the project fails to meet the required demand in the year 2020. And there are very specific numbers that say that. There's a reduction factor applied to the existing zoning and to the project zoning. And when you look at that, under existing zoning in 2020, there's a projection for 1,168 acre-feet of water. For the project, in that same year, there's a projection for 1,196 acre-feet of water. That means the project's demand is 28 acre-feet per year higher in 2020 than the existing zoning. And that makes it very difficult to rely on this approach of the water supply assessment and say that there's going to be enough water for the project because of the comparison of existing zoning, because it just doesn't work out. The numbers are on page 4 of the water supply assessment. You can look at them. They're there clearly. That's all I have. I thank you very much for your time and consideration.
Any questions at this point? Yep. While it's fresh on our mind, Rob, would you come up and discuss some of the things that were talked about today?
Yeah, I will. Thank you, Mr. President. Okay, took some notes here. I'm going to try to hit the ones there that I can, and please bear with me on some of these here. Let's see here. Okay, so we'll start with the deficit here that they're talking about in the Urban Water Management Plan. So as we talked about here a couple months back there, when the board approved the Urban Water Management Plan for the district, the Urban Water Management Plan is basically set up where it talks about the demands for the district, and then the supplies for the district here, and then the conservation that would go to match the two. It's set up in three different parts there. So what is happening here with some of this information that you're getting is it's kind of stopping at what I call Section 7 in the Urban Water Management Plan there. It's not getting into the conservation, which is going to basically balance the projected demands with what was being proposed by our wholesaler for supply. So that's that topic here. When we talk about, let's see, verifying that water is available, the deficit. Okay, so as far as they're talking about the conservation here, approximately a 35% conservation requirement for the developments, and that being difficult to achieve. Now, keep in mind here, I've got the correct slide up here. When we talk about these conservation numbers here, this is pre-conservation. When I say pre-conservation, I mean this is not taking into account 2015 demands. Now, we know what happened in 2015. The district conserved over 25% right there, nearly 26%. So taking that 26% here that we've conserved district-wide, and then also with this slide here, you see that the new Sierra project is proposing 11% less than what our draft 2014 master plan has assumed for that same land use here. You can get to 35% here pretty simply, actually, not that difficult. There was talk here about the gray water systems. That's actually a good point here. The gray water systems is something here that was just mentioned. It was not taken into account here in the actual data or the factors here as something that's going to be implemented. It was just something that was talked about in the reports. And as far as a district-wide perpetual conservation requirement here, to meet it here. Again, this is going back to the Urban Water Management Plan. Basically, sections 8 and 9 set up what conservation is needed to meet the supplies that we have here. And we've been working on that. We've done a great job of that. Our conservation department's been doing outstanding on it there. That's why we were able to do about 26% conservation there in 2015. As far as the duty factors here, there was talk here about the 200 gallons per day per acre for open space. Yes, we do. We do include that there for the reasons here I was talking there with Director Hernandez about. We do hold that there because we do have open space accounts that actually do use water. Okay, as far as 1,168 acre feet versus 1,196 acre feet there, basically this is, we're not necessarily 28 acre feet short there. This is what this is trying to do in the water supply assessment is show a range of conservation that needs to be met there. Approximately this 26 to 36% range needs to be met in order to basically balance our supply and demand here. So the low end of that range was approximately that 1,196 acre feet there, but that's the low end of the range here. And so we could be talking anywhere between 26 and 36% on that. Did I miss anything?
Director Martin, you have a question?
Yeah, the bottom line is you're showing 1.45 MGD demand estimated for the new CR project. Do we have that water for the next 20 years?
Yes, according to the water supply assessment there, yes, right. We can meet that.
Okay, mm-hmm. And that's not putting in, they're gonna be able to save more, they say, right? That's not including that, is it? Or is it including that?
Including putting in like the conservation you're talking about there? No. Correct. So, the conservation brings us down to about the 26 to 36% range like we're talking about here. So if you're asking me here, can we do 1.5 million gallons per day, according to the water supply assessment, the conservation is necessary on top of that to make it work, if that answers your question.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Oh, one other question, our water supply demand, is that showing, and I'm assuming that obviously a desal is a great part of our water supply, now it's 25%. Not what the governor says, that's not California waters, that's our water. We know that number's gonna go up at some point in time. Would that be true?
It is something that we are researching and it's a possibility, yeah.
Well, isn't Santa County Water Authority, weren't they looking at a 50% actually doubling the capacity, assuming they get all of the permits? It's testing right now at 50 MGD, but they're gonna go to 100 with very little extra work, because the pipeline can handle it, unless that would be the choke point, my understanding is. But we don't use those numbers at all, do we?
No, we don't use those numbers there. When the County of Water Authority does move forward with that there, I do believe we have the option of looking at expanding our desal take if we would like.
Well, if I understand, we can buy anything over 50 that they produce.
Oh, you're, I see what you mean. Okay.
So, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I can't hear. I'm sorry. We just cannot hear the discussion.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Somebody work on the...
Director Hernandez, you have your hands up?
Not so soft.
Robert, can you further elaborate on the whole conversation as it pertains to rationing? I saw that referenced in a number of the letters that we've received leading up to tonight, and I think that there seems to be some misunderstanding by the general public and our ratepayers that they're going to be rationing 35%, but that's not my understanding. Can you kind of elaborate on that a little bit? You touched on it a second ago, but.
Yes, President Sinella, thank you very much. That's a great question. I did notice that as well here. There seems to be quite a misunderstanding here with a lot of the notices that we've received here, that they're, because of the Newland Sierra project, that is gonna require a district-wide conservation effort so that we actually have water supply available for this development here, which is not the case.
So what conservation effort would be required if it's not district-wide?
Basically, It's going to be what we've been doing. And as far as the Newland Sierra development, they're proposing to put in their conservation measures to lower their projected demands as well. And so that's going to help us achieve what we need to meet our water supply as stated in the urban water management plan.
Thank you. Could you maybe elaborate or go into a little bit further discussion on the point of the water authority's demand projections being different than Vallecitos?
So I think what they're referring to here is in the County Water Authority's 2015 Urban Water Management Plan, they used a slightly different methodology to basically project water demands for each of, the, of its individual member agencies, including us here. And they use that, they still used SANDAG information to get there, but they put that into a modeling technique, which also did include conservation, which ours does not include here. Ours goes in after the fact. So they are coming up with much lower numbers than we did in our urban water management plan.
Thank you. Director Martin?
I have a question for our council.
Yes.
Our second speaker for Golden Door, said something about the good people of Twin Oaks having to pledge their water. I didn't understand that at all. I'm going to ask them, but have you ever heard of such a thing?
I didn't. I don't think I understood that either. If I don't understand the question, you know, I don't think I get it.
I need him to come back up and explain what he said, pledging water. It's a word I've never heard in this place.
Thanks, Rob.
If it could be the gentleman who said it, rather than Chris, because Chris, you're too good, quite frankly.
Yeah, you better stay down there.
Yeah. Your reputation.
You don't want me to talk, I'll say that. Director Martin, I'm actually not sure that I said that the Twin Oaks would be pledging their water.
Yeah, you did. Okay. I wrote it down at the same time you said it. Pledging? I've never heard of
pledging
it.
Pledging their water?
Yeah, to Newland, because if they were running low on water, they would have to pledge some of their water. I'm sure I heard that.
I think the point was that the entire district requires that you have a 35% reduction. So everybody across the board is going to be in a high drought level. So that's what I was saying.
Oh, okay.
So that across the board, everybody.
There's no pools of water,
you know, between one place and another.
Okay.
Right. So everybody is in the same boat, although yours is in a unique boat in that your water supply, urban water management plan shows that you start in a deficit. Nobody else in the state starts in a deficit under the urban water management plan.
And have you ever heard of the state rationing water?
The state rationing water?
Yeah, have we done that?
No, I mean Governor Brown's request that everybody cut back by 20%, which was achieved, was probably about the most radical thing that's been done, and the people of the state of California stepped up and did that.
I'm a little older, so when I hear rationing, it's probably some of the good folks in Twin Oaks here. They think of World War II, one tire per car, 1 gallon of gas. That's never happened here.
No, except though that what the plan does state is that you will be required to have a 35% reduction perpetually to be able to meet your demands under the land use assumptions that everybody is making. So when we talk about rationing, it's a rationing between what your supply is and what your demand is. So it's a reduction that your customers are going to have to achieve. But we've never done that.
You're saying the customer is going to have
they haven't achieved it yet.
As if it's a certainty.
The document actually does say it's a certainty. The document says that it is required for you to meet demands. That if you don't do the conservation, you will not have enough water to serve your public. And so that's what your water management plan is saying. I understand that the people of California have stepped up and they have achieved those really great savings. The question becomes, and there's an article that we attached for you from Gary Arant, about whether or not ongoing conservation is achievable, whether or not it's right to continue to ask people to conserve even if you have a normal year, and whether or not it's
it's sort of the right thing to do. So, I mean, that's a policy judgment that, that you guys are going to have to make as to whether or not you live in a perpetual drought condition or that you lift that. And I would note that you guys just recently pulled back from your level two drought requirements, that it was the 20% reduction, and told people that they didn't need to do, or do certain conservation, which may affect this plan because you're not doing the same conservation that you have been doing.
Thank you, President Sinnell. I would like to just briefly rebut a few things that were said by the Golden Door presentation. First of all, I want to just state that we did not say that the demand factors were wrong. What we did is we made adjustments for non-irrigated open space and took that demand factor off. Those demand factors don't consider conservation. And so we went beyond that with the demand factors and came up with adjustments based on conservation, which, as Robert Scholl pointed out, are in chapters 8 and 9 of the Urban Water Management Plan. And I think also the Golden Door presentation stated that how are you going to enforce these conservation measures that Nolan Sierra is talking about? Those conservation measures come right out of the state law. The Cal Green Code and the Model Water Efficiency Landscape Ordinance, which were updated in 2015. We're just taking those ordinances and applying them to a modern home with efficient appliances and efficient fixtures and efficient outdoor landscaping, and further prohibiting front yard turf in the development. Plus, I'll just point out that there is SBX 7-7, which is a separate state ordinance on all water districts, that by 2020 you will achieve a 20% reduction in water demand. So, lastly, there was discussion about the gray water systems. They're not a part of any of these calculations. That's going to be an additional potential savings. They are difficult to permit right now, but that's going to change. It's going to evolve over time. And it's a good use of water to irrigate your lawn with gray water. And we're going to try to keep pushing for that, but it's not considered in any of these numbers you've seen tonight. Thank you.
My question is on the gray water. We have a few facilities already that have been in town that have been built with dual pipe systems. The quad over there, Mike McDonald's project, he built dual pipe system, which you can't hook up to the health department staff. But we know those are going to change. My question is, as they said, we're not a land use authority. So once you leave here, you don't have to do it.
Correct.
Unless the city or the county makes you do it.
Yeah, but the Newland Sierra is committed to making that a part of the specific plan that gets approved by the county. So
you are making it part of the specific plan?
Yes, it is.
Director Hernandez.
And regardless if they made it part of the specific plan or not, the state, through these other two documents, the codes you mentioned, demand that they do that.
Well, they demand the conservation. Absolutely.
Exactly.
Yeah, the conservation is dictated by the state, not by the county.
Thank you.
And that's the way we're going to have to build in the future.
Thanks.
Robert, can you come back up? And I thank everybody for their patience who have speaker slips. I just, there's clearly two sides of this story, and I just want to make sure I can wrap my head around it. Can you elaborate, Rob, on what you had mentioned when you were up here last, that the estimates that the Golden Door team was talking about stopped at Section 7 of the plan, and that if you got on to 8 and 9 and so forth, that if you took that into account, that's how you guys came up with your recommendation. Can you elaborate that for everybody as to what's in those sections that you said if we would have continued on going down the document?
Sure. Okay, so the Urban Water Management Plan for the district is divided into 10 sections here. And the first few sections, like I said, they are dealing with our water demands. And then the next few sections here, which go 5, 6, and section 7, talk about the water demands there. And section 7 is the section that compares those two there. And that's what's showing the deficit, which is included there in a lot of the correspondence that we received from Latham and Watkins. Latham, Latham and Watkins there, I apologize. And then sections 8 and 9 deal with demand management measures and conservation measures that we will take to lower those demands there so we do balance our demands with what is being supplied there by the County Water Authority in our DSAL.
Can you talk about some of that and more specifics?
Okay, so I really wish I had Mr. Rodmus here for a lot of that there, but we're talking about, for instance, our tiered rate structure here, how we charge more there for additional water uses there. We talk about the drought structure, drought staging, drought stages 1 through 4. So as more conservation is required, we have more conditions or restrictions that we put on water usage. Those are two examples right there.
Okay. And then can you further clarify, because this 35% rationing still gets, it just got brought up again after you sat down. Mm-hmm. Is it something that's going to impact us district-wide, or is it specific to the conservation efforts by the applicant?
This, as far as the water supply assessment is concerned, this is for the applicants here. We're not talking district-wide. So what Latham and Watkins is talking about is that gap there in the urban water management plan between supply and demand there and making that up there. So they're saying the difference there is approximately in that 35% range. And that's based on the data that we had at the time we put together urban water management plan. We had a certain demand projection for 2020 through 2035 there. If those demands come to fruition, then we would be required to conserve that much to meet it there based on the demands that the County Water Authority is supplying us. Now, if those demands don't materialize here because, well, we continued our conservation, which we have been doing here, and then development doesn't come as quickly as it has been, which we're finding that's the case now, likely that's going to be a much lower target that we're shooting for than that approximately 11 billion gallons that we would need to satisfy demands in 2020.
Yeah. Thank you. Did anybody else have any questions?
I had one.
Oh, Director Offer, sorry.
Could you respond to the, I think the second speaker for Golden Door mentioned Water Code Section 1019.10. And with reference to the fact that you can't use conserved water as new supplies?
Okay, Mr. Williams might have been referring to the San Juan Capistrano case on that there. Is that what I'm understanding about using a tiered rate structure?
No, it was with regards to conserved water and being able to show that as new water supply.
Okay, I guess I'm not understanding there, because that's exactly what our urban water management plan does there. It says we are going to have demand management measures and conservation measures to achieve basically the demands that we need to meet supplies.
Yeah, I heard the statement made by the gentleman that the water code prohibits the use of conserved water.
If that's the case there, I would like to know from DWR that I'm putting incorrect urban water management plans together there for the last 10 years, because that's basically how we've done it in the past.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Another question? Tom, thanks for your patience.
Thank you.
And thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you. Thank you, President Sinella. Thank you, the board. As I was watching this, several comments come up and concerns. You know, who do you believe? Conservation, is it part of the urban water plan, or can it not be discussed or used? If a lawyer, a law firm says that it shouldn't be used, and your own staff is not sure, I think you need time to find out from your attorneys what's the status. And I think the question is legitimate. So I don't think you can make a decision tonight regarding the water assessment or verification plan. A lot of assumptions have been used. Mr. Hernandez pointed out that currently on this property of over 1985 acres, no water is being used. But the applicant says, hey, we're entitled to put in our projection 200 acres of water per day, or you know, some form of it, when they say at the no project level, it uses so much water. And then when you look at our project, under the water assessment plan, it's going to save 11%. Well, how can that be realistically? Unless you know you're taking some paper numbers when you're not utilizing any water at all. Some of the assumptions about the home builder foundation studies of 4 occupants per home in terms of use, those are old facts. I know people that are cramming into homes because of the current economy. And so some of these factors or assumptions that are being used have to be reviewed. In terms of conservation of water, in the past, I would try to capture rainwater, you know, trying to save. But with the outbreak of Zika and other mosquito-borne illnesses, I don't think you're gonna see people do that as much. In fact, when I'm at the Lake San Marcos Kiwanis Club, meeting with my other fellow members, some of them are still active at 80, 90 years old. How much more water can you ask them to conserve? I don't think it's fair. In terms of trying to meet the gap, you know, in terms of here's the supply, here's the demand, we have a shortage, we're gonna do it through conservation or demand management. But your own staff couldn't even come off of the top of his head. What were the things to get you there? That's a concern that I have, just watching. You know, tiered rates. So you're going to punish people for, you know, saving or conserving right now, and you're going to punish them even more by giving them higher rates or putting some drought standards that they have to meet. One of the comments was, well, if you do something wrong, the Vallecitos Water District is going to be out of luck. Well, it's not you guys that are going to be out of luck. It's the people that live in the district and outside that district, because we're going to try to have to help figure out how you're going to get that water. Water is life, and so you should not treat it lightly. It's not a joke, and take the time to study it, which you are. But if you don't have the facts, get the facts.
Thank you. Don Lindsay. Hi, Don.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for allowing this opportunity. I appreciate it. I'm actually not, you know, with a proposal or any kind of PowerPoint presentation. I don't have fancy charts or anything. I'm a homeowner in that community, and I'm a recent homeowner. I bought my home about 3.5 years ago, and in that 3.5 years, I wasn't told that there was 2,100 homes basically going across my street. I looked to that valley of Newland, or the proposed valley. And with that, you know, it wasn't disclosed to my purchase of the home. I bought that home because I wanted a rural community. I wanted to make sure I had a nice country, quiet environment, and that's not what I'm gonna get if this goes through. I know from your perspective, it's more of a water situation here, and I wanna make sure that I, you know, stay on point for that. But I have concerns with the fact that, you know, that before we even put the water in and we build this community, we can't even get the roads to get the people in there. We can't get the people out of it safely. So I'm, you know, joining Tom's group with the sponsor groups to try to make sure that before all decisions are made, that everything is considered, that there's due diligence. I'm an accountant, I've been an accountant for 23 years, I work at Callaway Golf, and I've spent my entire working life basing everything on numbers and facts and statistics. I take everything and I take historical information, I put it into trends, I can give you forecasts, I can give you all that stuff. I got this report of 150 pages yesterday afternoon. I spent my lunch hour, 1 hour reading through it. I found dozens of mistakes and things that conflict in there. I implore you guys to take the time, do your due diligence, get all the facts. The first thing I pick up on this report, it's a 2008 report. Well, technically they call it a 2014 report, but it's based off of 2008 statistics and numbers. They actually write in there that very few changes. Few means three to me. So very few, does that mean two? So they've had two changes since 2008? I think that's hard to believe that we're gonna base a lot of information and make a lot of decisions for future for a lot of people off of a 2008 report. So that's where I'm coming from, that I hope that we can actually put some information together that makes sense, that can be realistically proven, and some facts that support it behind it before any decisions made.
Thank you, Don. Mike Hunsaker.
Mike Hunsaker. Three quick points. First, while we talk about non-irrigation open spaces, we do not talk about the community gardens, the irrigated fire protection zones. Under your drought measures, you exempt these areas from any water restrictions, period. This provides almost 400 acres of competing agricultural land with no restrictions at all. How do you have a water man management system that puts such great gaps in the whole system? Item two, the urban water management plan does not fairly and accurately measure potential demand. It leaves out the new density bonuses. The plan was based on zoning allowances and did not include the density bonuses. Item three, developers read your reports. They know that you are nearing the 30% moratorium level very quickly. We now have a frenzy of overbuilding going on, going far beyond the 30% level. It is imperative that we look at what is already permitted and what is coming online. I went down to the San Marcos Planning Commission. I asked for a list of the new projects in progress. The clerk gasped. It was 6 pages long. You have instituted an overbuilding frenzy with massive requirements for conservation. Well, this conservation is not conservation. It is impairment of the water rights of the existing ratepayers. And they're going to get this transferred to new developers at little cost to themselves. We need to go beyond just this issue of Newland Sierra. We need to look at the whole picture of development.
Tony Eason. Evening, Tony.
Hi, directors. My name is Tony Eason. I'm a resident of the Deer Springs Oaks Mobile Home Park, located directly across the road from the proposed project. And it's a community that's been there about, it's a cooperatively owned community that's been there about 60 years. And of course, me as well as many other residents are concerned about such a large project going in so close to us. And specifically here with the demands, the water demands that such a large project will require in the face of an ongoing drought in the state and the world, and major conservation measures required very recently. Now, I can't analyze the 2015 urban water management plan like the experts have here, but when I looked at it, that clearly showed that, and this plan did not, the version of it that I saw did not include the Newland proposal. It showed that there was a significant shortfall projected for every year for normal single dry and multiple dry years for the next 20 plus years. They calculated things in order to meet the demand acquiring desalinated water from outside, which is very expensive water, we know that, as well as other outside resources through the San Diego Water Authority, referred to in the document I read as existing and planned supplies. To me, those things are not only expensive, but they're pretty vague. And in order to balance the books on the supply and demand table that I read, about 30% of the demand was accounted for by conservation. Now, 30% of conservation, in addition to the roughly 25-30% that the state and county has had to do just in the last year, is an awful lot to ask for conservation to account for. Now, is that possible? And according to the water district's books, it says that the cost of that the 30% conservation isn't really possible. It says that conservation should account for about 70% of the demand reduction by 2020. So that's a pretty far distance in there. My concern is, to me, we need to reduce the future demand. And that, to me, would mean no development should be considered unless we have adequate, confirmed, affordable water for the immediate future. Otherwise, in the face of ongoing increasing conservation demands, increasing cost of the additional water you have to bring in from desal plants and stuff like that, is going to make major changes in the lifestyle of a lot of the residents in the area. My community is fixed income seniors, and that's going to change our lifestyle big time. I guess that meant my time was up.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Stephanie Schubert.
I'm sorry, I'm not very professional. I'm from Europe, but I am since 3 years the assistant spiritual director of a church right at Sarver Lane. We own 25 acres. We are there since about 50 years, and as a church focusing on meditation, we are very concerned about the development. Our interests are very similar to the Golden Door. Preserving the nature, preserving the silence, and keeping the area rural. Unfortunately, our president of the board, who would be better equipped to speak, can't be here now. He is a developer, actually managing director of single and multifamily housing in an Orange County big company, and he is very strong opposed to this particular development and this particular way of developing. I thought that might interest you. He's also supporting all the points Latham and Watkins has made that I could not refer to as professionally as they can. All of our members are very concerned about this. Before the 21st September proposed meeting, you have received a lot of emails, I believe. Today, the public is not properly represented because the change of date and the time, 5 p.m., and a lot of traffic. I also happen to have been working as an architect in my previous life, and so I can offer a maybe broad outside view of this kind of development. I'm not able to go into all the details, but what I'm seeing is that we are selling our land cheaply to developers that get the land cheap, knowing that they don't have to listen to the general plan paid by taxpayers, that they don't have to listen to how much water is really there, and they can still, unfortunately, more or less get approved whatever they want to. It's starting to get more and more difficult, though, which I believe is a very good thing. Very simply said, no new development saves water. However, obviously, as an architect, I'm not against development. I have a lot of experience in Europe, in big developing areas, where the focus is on clustering multifamily housing near public transportation. Since the water supplies are limited, I am wondering if we should not keep the water for these kinds of developments. If we give all the water away now to developments with big outside spaces, well, later on, we're going to be run out of space for recreation, for housing, and we won't have enough water to support more conserving, more progressive development.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Thank you very
appreciate
much.
Appreciate you coming in, and you are very professional.
I haven't said about anything about the prices, which of course is also a concern. Desalination takes a lot of energy, not just energy.
Thank you. Elsa, I'm sorry, I can't read the last name.
Morris.
Morris, thank you.
Good evening. I submitted a letter to you on my email. I don't know if you've seen it, but I can sign. I guess my main concern is I'm a property owner in the district, have been for over 30 years, and a past customer of yours, and I'm now relying on groundwater. My concern is whether or not the water assessment, water supply verification that you are considering complies with the government code as it relates to assessing and describing the impacts on groundwater for agricultural and industrial uses. We have agricultural uses on our property. We abut the project area on the northwest side. So I have some concerns about that. And the one speaker said she read everything in 1 hour. Well, I tried to read everything last night on my cell phone by flashlight because we're totally off the grid except for electricity for our well. And it took me many hours, and I still don't understand it all. So if you did provide that description with respect to groundwater, I would like you to tell me where it is so I can look at it. Thank you.
You said you're completely off the grid? No,
yes.
No electricity at all?
Only our well. And our agricultural project, we've been gone for several years and we just came back. We have exotic bamboo and palms, and we have a project where we are developing a living tree seed bank for rainforest trees that are in danger of extinction. And we collect the seeds ourselves, grow the trees, and plant them on our project in Central America. Thank you.
Did you have a question? I just wanted to say, I think that's great you're on a well. I know a lot of people that use well water.
Right.
And then I always remind them the reason why this water district was put together is because the groundwater was running out.
Can I say one other thing about that is I know in the project area there was an irrigation assessment district formed in the 1970s. And this district put in a lot of infrastructure in the project area, and to my knowledge, none of it was used, or at least now there are no agriculture planned anticipated for use in the project area. People are cutting down their trees, turning off their water, and avocados, is pretty much out of the question anymore.
Thank you.
That concludes the public speaker slips that I had, unless Diane, did you have any more over there? Okay. So I'd like to invite staff back up, either Tom or Rob, if we can maybe address some of the concerns by the community.
Okay, certainly here. Let's see. I know Tom, bring this up here. I know Tom had some discussion here on the per capita usage there for each home and how that plays into the document. It doesn't. So I just want to let him know that there. And Tom there, I do apologize there for not having all of the demand management measures known there off the top of my head. But in addition to the ones here that I did talk about here, about the tiered rate structure, about our emergency allocations or stages 1 through 4 there. We do a lot of other stuff as well there. We have education. We do a lot of outreach there, with booths and tours. and we do go to a lot of the schools there and do a lot of the presentations to them there, and those are part of it too. Those are included. Okay. Oh, okay. Talking about the irrigated fire protection zones here. So the development is proposing approximately 400 acres of fire protection barrier. Some of it is proposed to be irrigated, some of it is not. That area that is not proposed, we treat that as open space as far as water demands are concerned. That area that is proposed to be irrigated, we treat it as parks as far as water demands are concerned, so that is addressed. The Urban Water Management Plan doesn't measure density bonuses. That's absolutely correct there. We do not get into density bonuses. We use the land use only for the different agencies. As far as
just to clarify, mm-hmm. you base it off the number of ADUs, the number of homes.
We base it off the land use, the approved land use of the different agencies. So, for instance, if you have a residential, like a 10 to 15 dwelling units an acre, and it's 10 acres there, we can assume that you'll have 15 dwelling units times 10 acres there, so you'd have 150 dwelling units for that.
Dr. Martin. Follow up that, the first gentleman speaker brought up the fact that there's nothing out there now, so it's not using water. So how do you explain 2,400 homes using less water than that? Maybe you could explain that.
Yeah, we're trying to do future to future comparisons here, not present to future comparisons here. And that's what our master plan document does, and thus our urban water management plan does as well here. So we're projecting, for instance, in our master plan that area uses a certain amount of water here. What is it there, 1.6? Yeah, 1.63 million gallons a day.
That's as it sits now, if it was zoned and working as agricultural.
That is how it is, the current approved land use is there with the county's 2011 general plan.
So that's the number we're using now. So that's the
correct.
Important thing to know that even though there's nothing there, we plan on having water for it to be ag.
Exactly.
Even though that's not going to happen or may happen in the future, it's already planned into the scheme of things that much water is going to be used.
Yes.
That's the important thing, because I understand his question, but it was like, well, we plan for it to be ag. That's already in the master plan, but they're going to use that much per acre, so it's already counted.
Exactly.
It's counted as being used, although it's not mm-hmm. physically being used.
And with the proposed developments, that number would be approximately 180,000 gallons per day less.
Thank you.
There was still a lot of discussion here about the shortfall projected urban water management plan. I think we addressed that there. And anything else in particular you want me to?
The issue on the groundwater?
Yeah, I'm not really understanding the groundwater question here. I know that the water supply assessment there doesn't get into the groundwater sources. We're just talking about our imported and diesel supplies.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions of staff? Mm-hmm. Yes, Rob?
Mm-hmm. I've got one question of legal staff.
Sure.
Mr. Scott, could you explain to us our role? We've heard it before, we know what it is, but could you explain it?
Well, first I'd like to thank all of the speakers and presentations, and I appreciate the water supply assessment verification report done by HDR and GSI, and the wealth of information we received today from an overtime, which incorporates a lot of it. But I think to address your question, first and foremost, I think it's important for everyone to understand that the district's not approving this project. It's simply just providing assessment and verifications based upon available information that it has to the county, and this will ultimately be decided whether the project moves forward based upon this assessment and verification. It'll be approved by the land use body. And as I've told you many times before, you're not a land use body. And yes, there's all of this is important, and there's important information here. But I think the EIR, this will all be part of that, and a lot of the statutes that we've talked about here are statutes that the county has to comply with in assessing this assessment, water supply assessment and verification report. So it's not to minimize anything that's been brought up, but I do think it's important that we understand that even in the legislation, SB 610, that was a component of this. There was also some additional legislation, but even in there, it declares in the beginning of that legislation, there are various factors that affect the ability to ensure that adequate water supplies are available to meet all California's water demands now and in the future. I mean, we are faced with this. And because of those factors, it is not possible to guarantee a permanent water supply for all water users in the amounts requested. But that's just the reality of life. So that's what we're dealing with, and we're trying from our perspective to try to assess and verify based upon other regional suppliers of what our water ability will be in the future. And the bottom line is nobody has a crystal ball. But I appreciate everybody's comments, and I think that basically is it. There are no guarantees.
Anything else, Director Martin?
To the first gentleman again, when you brought up something about, I forget what it was exactly, but you did an eloquent job, thank you. But we are your neighbors. The five of us, the four of us up here, are your neighbors. We all live in town, we all pay water bills. We all understand the problem. To the young lady that stood up and talked about infrastructure, basically. You brought up infrastructure, roadways, those kind of things. You know, the reality is, and we're not land use authority, but the reality is from the land use authority's position, the way you develop infrastructure is good development. Your taxes aren't ever gonna build that road. And maybe that's the reason we're all here, I don't know. But your taxes are gonna build that road. It's gonna take a developer to build that road and to change that interchange and make it bigger and get that roadway so that it's not clogged. Not our use, I'm just bringing it up to you so that you know, as an aside. And to the other gentleman who lives in the mobile home park, that one death an average month that's on that road, and all the emergency vehicles that you hear going up and down your road, that might be a little bit squirreled by it, but I'm not a land use authority person. And I think that's all I have to say, is that sometimes some of the words I heard here tonight, moratorium, pledging, I've never heard before. So I don't know if they're scare words or tactics, I have no idea. But I for one, have to rely on our staff. Our staff works for the water board. They have our interest and the interest of our ratepayers. And then we have two sides, both have hired guns here, gunslingers that shoot it out. But I always rely on our staff because they work for the ratepayers. They're paid, the check is signed by the ratepayers. So I listen to our staff and what their opinions are greatly.
Fred Hernandez.
I have, we've heard this a number of times over the years relative to our water needs and the great job we have done in our conservation in not only Vallecitos, but in the county. Part of what irritates that by jeebers out of me is what is coming from the governor's office, that we are in a drought. And if those of you that were reading the papers and everything, the great job that we have done over the last 15 years or more in bringing desal so we ensure that we do have water, raising San Vicente Dam so that we all have water, bringing water from the Colorado River through Imperial Valley that is not using all their water. We have water to the extent that we had to send more than a million of gallons out to the ocean because the governor said we had a restriction. We personally didn't have a restriction. It was a mandate put on us. So the good job that we have been doing, the more than 20%, and that's a mandate again, that 2020, all that coming together, we have met. The additional 36%, I don't know where that came from, but it's not real. That is not another demand that is going to be put on top of us. We are not a land use authority. You heard that. We're not here to approve the project. We are here just to let this applicant know that based on the numbers that we put together and the constant conservation efforts that we have already done and that are going to be mandated to them in the future, that supply and demand will balance out and will be even better on their side. And I'm not surprised that they're up in arms about the 240,000 gallons, which is the 200 gallons per acre on the 1,200 that they have used in their conversation that our staff is not able to use. So there is even more or even less water than they have identified is going to be used. So I just want my ratepayers and our ratepayers know that we do have, with the conservation that we have been doing, we have water and we'll continue to have water.
I don't either. So unless there's an additional discussion, I'll entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Diane, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Director Alucard?
Yes.
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 I'd like to recess, sir.
Sure. We'll take a 5-minute break.
Okay. Thank you, President Snell, members of the board. Next item here is final acceptance of the water improvements for the Double Peak Elementary School. Now, typically, we do these on a consent calendar basis here, but this one here we just kind of threw at you there just because it's the elementary school. Just real quick here. This development there basically replaced approximately 407 feet of 16-inch pipeline that was in the middle of where they wanted to build. So that got moved there to the north a little bit. And they also put in about a 32-foot section of 16-inch there on the southwest portion of the property. They also put in a small, about 117-foot, 8-inch stub there, a little bit more west there for their own water service as well. So the development there, they've paid all their capital facility fees here. They've completed all their annexation process. With that in mind there, I'd like to recommend acceptance of the project improvements and approving of the filing of the notice of completion for the project.
Okay. Director Hernandez.
No. Second, just to be clear, they paid for all of that?
The water capital facility fees and the water main
right, the moving and all that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that was on the developer.
That was on the school district.
Our ratepayers did not have to pay a penny towards any of that?
Correct. That's correct.
That's correct. I want to make sure that at every juncture we keep hearing that the developer is pushing financing and cost to our ratepayers, and I just want to reiterate at every chance that is absolutely not true. And here's a case in point. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Okay. There was a motion. There was a motion and a second. Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, Ron.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Good job, Ron.
Okay. Item 2.3, Vallecitos headquarters sites. And we got James.
thank you, President Snell, members of the board. I actually don't recall which board meeting it was, but a few board meetings ago, the board requested that we look at the back hill on our site, basically the undeveloped portion of where the Vallecitos Watershed headquarters sits, and take a look at what potential opportunities are on that. And what we did since then is we went forward and we went and got an engineer who does development to assist us in this process. And what we're going to present to you today is basically some of the kind of the forward planning that a developer would do, basically just show you potentials at this, and understanding also that these are just potentials, there's pros and cons to them, and obviously there's a whole process of entitlements, and also there's a process that still needs to go through. With that, the site is...
Quick question, James, is this all pro bono, I hope?
No, we actually retained the engineer to do this work.
At what cost?
About $9,100.
Well, that's how much we're in it so far.
So the site is 67 point, a little bit of history here, 67.1 acre site. We developed it for the headquarters in 1997. The city acquired 14 acres and working with the San Marcos Youth Baseball back in 06 to develop the Mission Sports Park, which sits adjacent to our property now. The remaining 32.7 acres is actually what we consider the hill or the hillside. The existing undeveloped hill, so of that 32.7 acres, a little bit over 30 acres is actually coastal sage, it's habitat. There is a eucalyptus tree grove, but it's pretty sparse, so we actually have coastal sage of a pretty moderate to high quality, even underneath the eucalyptus grove. We have some minor disturbed areas, mainly kind of adjacent to our parking lot. And then we have slope constraints that are greater than 25%. And it took me a little bit to understand that, but apparently when you have slope constraints greater than 25%, usually it takes additional planning commission approval and so on and so forth. So that is one of the things that the engineer pointed out that can be an issue. And that's why I mentioned it here. It is zoned for residential and also has industrial use on site. Also, cultural site is located near the top. And that was all in the environmental impact report from the development of this facility. So the red that you see up here is basically all the slopes. So you can see there's a large portion of the site that is impacted by slopes greater than 25%. With that, the district did hire project design consultants to evaluate what our options are. Again, these are potentials. And what they did is they evaluated what if the site was turned into an environmental conservancy that the district could use to offset capital improvement costs. So when we go in and we disturb coastal sage, we have to mitigate it at somewhere 3-to-1, and that costs money. So this would be a direct offset, lowering our capital costs on projects. Another one was a moderate development with or without a reduced environmental conservancy. So there is a potential for a small development on site with still a conservancy, and or we could use the conservancy to offset the development. Those are two different options. So again, the moderate development without the conservancy, and the last one is what we call the max development. So getting into this here, this is a table that they provided that had all the pros and cons kind of each site. I'm not going to go through the options, but I wanted to make it available and we could go back to it if we need to. But what I did is I went ahead and highlighted some of these things in the next few slides. So, starting with the environmental conservancy, you got about roughly 30 and a half acres. It's about a 1 to 2 year process. We had numbers on this because it's available. Right now, coastal sage is about $30,000 an acre, so roughly $1 million worth of mainly used for offsets of district costs. If we don't use it all, we could also actually bank it and sell it as a mitigation bank.
James, is that one time or is that recurring every year?
No, that's one time.
One time. Mm-hmm.
Also with that, there are future cost benefits as more land gets developed, mitigation land becomes less available, the cost of mitigation goes up. For example, when we're looking at our project for wetland, mitigation costs are $600,000 an acre. I don't think coastal sage will ever get there, but just as an example, while 10, 15 years ago when I was looking at wetland mitigation costs, it was about $120,000 an acre. Okay, the moderate development. So with that, we have residential and industrial use. What you see in the picture here is the, let me get this right, the green is the fill and the red or the orange, however it comes on your screen, is actually the cut to make it a balanced site so you don't have to bring in dirt or export dirt. Up to 42 residents on this, it's about a 2.1 acre site. The zoning allows for up to 20 residents an acre. 126,000 square feet of industrial and about a 17,000 square feet of commercial on roughly a 0.4 acre site. 17.7 acres, which is all this untouched land, kind of in the middle. I'm sorry, the red doesn't show up well, but in the middle here, that could be used as a conservancy, just like option one, or not. So there's an option here. So I'm not going to show you four different slides. This one is with or without the conservancy. It's the same picture, basically. 1.5 to 3 years, if we go down a process here, about 90,000 cubic yards of earthwork. So it's fairly significant. And we have moderate mitigation costs. So in other words, if you are going to conserve the coastal sage in the middle, the development would have to go and find coastal sage to mitigate, which adds cost to the development. So what that looks like is this. We have basically two industrial lots that backs up to our facility. And one of the reasons and one of the concerns when in developing and going through kind of the criteria is it's a bad idea to invite neighbors, residents in the back of the facility, because even though we're not a 24/7 facility, we have the potential to be a 24/7 facility with emergency shutdowns, water main breaks, and our equipment and vehicles, they beep when you back up, they're loud. Plus, you don't want to have neighbors kind of looking over your fence, knowing when nobody's there. It invites loitering, invites vandalism on site. So the industrial use there has kind of the same working hours as we would have at our facility. And the residential is kind of off of Knoll Road. That's a 2.1 acre site. And then that that orange or pink, however, shows up on your screen, kind of on the corner of Mission and Knoll, that's the commercial site. That's what we said they have commercial viability because of its location. And that's roughly 0.4 acres.
I'm sorry, point?
0.4.
Oh, thank you.
A little less than half. Maximum development. Again, I'm not going over the moderate development with and without the environmental because it's the same exact picture. The maximum development, you have up to 164 residential units, a little bit over 178,000 square foot of industrial, and the commercial is the same, about 17,000 square foot, 2 to 4 years, but you're moving 523,000 cubic yards of earthwork, basically the balance of site. And as you can see from the picture, it's the whole site. Basically, all 32 acres is being regroomed, sloped, and moved. And there'd be major mitigation costs for that, because you'd have to go out and find 90 to 100 acres of coastal sage to actually mitigate it. So with that, this is what the site would look like. You actually have three industrial lots, again, sticking with the same theme, they're kind of abutting to the backside or up against the district property. And then you have five residential lots. Comprising of those 164 units. Obviously, with this one here, you have the private streets and public streets. They go through, so you have circulation. Unlike the other one, there are private streets with a public cul-de-sac into a private street.
I do have a question.
Oh.
Shouldn't the top of that say maximum development?
Oh, I'm sorry. That's a typo. Yes, it should.
Okay.
When I copied it over, I didn't change the heading. My apologies. So that is the maximum.
Could you take over the mic, Ed?
Ed, please.
Sorry, James.
So.
Okay, just confused me for a moment.
Yeah, tough crowd tonight. So again, there's five residential lots on this proposal. And again, I just want to reiterate, these are kind of what the initial forward planning or the initial potentials are for that. With that, kind of the process, kind of skipping around a little bit, you have the district surplus property process. If the environmental conservancy process is something that the board's interested in, that's a fairly straightforward process that staff has experience with. That's meeting with the resource agencies, getting the biological done, getting the mapping done, and then going through their process themselves. As far as the development process, the next step in the development process, once we determine how to get there, is really the entitlement process. And that's where within the entitlements could take that more than a couple years, 2 to 4 years before everything is entitled. Because the zoning that's allowed for it does allow it some, the 25% slopes, but however, this is kind of the process as laid out. So with that, I'd be happy to try to answer any questions.
Director Martin.
Did you look at avocados?
You know, we have a little bit of history in avocados, and they weren't very successful, so I ended up cutting that one out.
So, oh, Director Hernandez.
And was there a cost potential in each of the, I mean, I heard you say about the conservancy, that's
$1 million.
$1 million, $30,000 an acre. Was there also a cost associated with either the moderate or the maximum development?
Yeah, it was hard to determine because as you are more aware of than I am, as you go through your entitlements, a lot of things change. So if everything fell into place, I'm having the engineers kind of work on estimates. But PDC at this level, at a $9,000 level, is not comfortable with actually putting numbers down that can be digested by a board or be digested by the community. Because you'd have to do a much deeper effort into your planning to really figure out what the cost is. They did give me earthwork costs. For example, the max development was almost $8 million in earthwork. They're comfortable with that, but depending on what the building designs are, what the final outcomes, the architectural layouts, those things all affect costs, as you were aware of. So they were not comfortable actually giving me a number on that.
Ballpark figure?
For max development?
Yeah.
They gave me huge ranges, like anywhere from $40 to $60 million to develop. You know, so that's not a
figure. What about the return side?
Return side, they gave me big ballpark figures, too, that showed net gains, of, depending on where you are, of zero to, you know, $5, $8 million.
Okay, was this based on just us selling the land outright to it?
No.
Or
no.
Is this some sort of land lease agreement?
No, that's the process, and that wasn't within the scope of the engineering. They're not appropriate to go over that scope of what we can and can't do with the land. What they were scoped to do is look at the potentials of the site, of how it can be developed most efficiently, and give me a proposal or give me some figures on that.
Director Martin.
Could you go back to the other slide showing the, thank you, I just wanted to take down some numbers here.
Did they look at a specific plan?
Yes, they looked at the city's plan, they looked at the zoning, they looked at the building ordinances.
Creating a specific plan for the area, in other words.
Oh, not at this point, no.
I mean, that's how most of the city's been built, with specific plans.
Yeah, they looked at the actual current zoning, but then, for example, this max development, I believe, would require a specific plan, but while the moderate zone, development may fit within the current city layout.
For the specific plan, you could knock out the industrial and do all homes. I mean, specific plan gives you a lot of latitude.
Yes.
And that would cost a lot more to have them look into, which is why I suggested that we have an outside firm do it.
And they are an outside firm. They're project design consultants. They specialize in land development.
Great job. Great job.
Director Evans?
Just a little bit back, Director Hernandez said, well, we know the cost on the Coast to Go Conservancy, and he mentioned $1 million. Now, I read this that you were saying there's an estimated value of $1 million to the district if we're a conservancy, not the cost?
Yes,
or am I confused?
That's not the cost. You're absolutely correct. The benefit would be about $1 million in offset on our capital-driven projects, for example. That's what we use it for, because we have to go out and buy mitigation land as we disturb open space land.
Okay, so there would be some cost in setting it up and dividing it up or using it, but it wasn't $1 million.
No, it was probably in the $100,000-$150,000 plus range, but there was also probably somewhere around the $5,000-$10,000 for maintenance. I talked to Center for Natural Lands Management. They kind of gave me a ballpark figure for that amount of site. So
maintenance, and then you were saying if that was an option that was chosen, that the value could go up as over time. Not, we're not going to guess 600.
No,
1,000 an acre. But that's what you were implying then, that this is what they're guessing right now.
Yeah, PDC retained Recon Environmental for this portion, and in discussion in the conference called Recon, they said the value of that land is pretty linear for a while, but over time it's going to end up going up. But right now there are coastal sage of mitigation lands available. However, the way it looks, especially as North County and San Diego County continues to develop, that becomes more scarce.
So if we have a major water leak, how much would have to be turn it into wetland? Just want to give you something to think about.
I'll start working on that.
Okay, cool.
Director Martin.
One last question, staff. Could you give us a printed copy of this, please?
Of this report?
Yeah.
Yes.
the city.
It's in the...
It's online.
Who is it?
Hey, James, and thanks for this, and I'm very intrigued by this whole concept, this idea of being able to possibly generate revenue that will benefit our ratepayers and put additional revenues into, our coffers, to our general fund, for lack of a better way of putting it, without actually having to take it from the ratepayers, right? This could be a really unique opportunity for us. What I'm a little bit surprised that some of the discussion that we've had on this initially was not only what were our options as far as developing it, but what were our options as far as, there seemed to be some questions with legal counsel. Do we have the same sort of abilities that the city of San Marcos had, for example, with regards to some of their agreements that they've done around town with land leases, or do we have to sell it outright and we just get a one-time lump sum? You said earlier that this particular consultant that you leveraged for this was not the one to tell us that?
No, that's a district policy. That's more for the district and district legal counsel and the board.
That's the memo I got. I think there's a memo there that I provided
you. The one that was given to us right as we sat down?
Yes, okay. For this item. Because yeah, I thought you might end up next, is what's the process.
Okay, so you want to we just literally got this.
I'd be happy to. Basically the first step is that I think it's fair to say that we're not, I hate to sound like a broken record, but we don't have the same policing powers and the same flexibility that a city would have in the sense of being able to designate a specific plan for this area. We're subject to the city's rules, if you will. So, but the first step is to declare this property surplus. And for a local agency like us, a special district. So what we would do is say, hey, we have no use for this property. So the first step is for it to come to you and you determine that we have no use for this. We're not going to put a tank up there. We decide that we're going to use it for mitigation purposes. We have no use for this, okay? Once that happens, there's a very strong public policy that's developed over the last few decades on low and moderate income housing, on recreational use, on other types of uses that the state legislature has mandated on local agencies' surplus properties. So that's the process where we would then say, hey, we've declared this property surplus. We send out letters primarily to the city and the local school district in accordance with the statute that I cite in the memo. And we say, hey, we've got this surplus property. Would you like to purchase it? Would you like to lease it? Would you have, you have any interest in it? And then they come to you and have, after a couple of months, they have a 90-day period to sit down and talk to you in good faith about, hey, here's the art of the possible here. Here's what we think. We'd like to purchase this property from you. I think at that point that it is critical from a variety of perspectives that you have a very good idea that depending upon the type of development that this goes through, what the value of it is. And it could be the value for the purchase price, it could be the value for a lease over time, it could be that. But that's where you really need to have somebody that can advise you, because we want to make sure if you get into negotiations with the city over this property that you're you have a sound understanding of what this development potential is and what the value of it is for you, that for the district. So after 90 days, the law is talking about, we want good faith negotiations, because if the city decides to buy it, they may want to, they have an obligation to make sure that 25% of it is for low and moderate income housing and some of the other things that they would have to apply on this property. So then, if the negotiations break down and we just feel that the city doesn't want to meet us and meet our what the district board considers is a fair price, then we have an obligation that's on the second page, gets into a lot of detail about whoever develops this property. would have to have at least 15% for low and moderate, and some other things in there that are statutory that would be required before that would have to be negotiated with the developer. It's possible, but that's the I'm just focusing in on the process. But I want you to understand that it isn't, you know, because we're not the city, it's not quite as easy to get there as it would be for a city, for example, that works with a developer and comes in and says, hey, we've got this property over here. You tell us what you can do, and we'll decide whether or not it's something we're interested in. So, yes.
Quick question, to cut to the chase. If the city wanted to purchase it to do affordable housing, we have to have a value before we put this thing in stuff, we need to put a value on it. But that value can be anything we determine it to be, because that's a very significant piece of property in the city of San Marcos.
Well,
and by the way, we must be getting rental income now from the FAA or whoever has the antenna on top. Yeah. I like to see that offset somewhere in the books.
Well, the point is that you would, that needs a more sophisticated, because of a constitutional provision with respect to gifts of public funds and grand juries and things like that. It can't be a sweetheart deal. It's got to have something that from your perspective, that we have is solid, that hey, we dispose of this property appropriately, it was surplus, but we got fair market value in whatever form that is.
I agree. Okay. Fair market value is what this board determines it to be. Yeah. For everybody, for the school district one.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I don't think the school district's gonna put a site up there, but I don't know. I don't know if we have,
any
I don't know what the city would
any
do.
Any public agency, right?
Yeah.
As we all public agencies.
Yeah.
I don't see that happening with either of them, I see a developer coming in, all probability.
Yeah, that's probably what would happen, and so that you have that alternative. But first you have to go and try to negotiate, if you will, in good faith with the city.
Director Martin.
Director Hernandez.
I guess the first question that we should be discussing is whether we want to do anything with it, because that still has not yet been determined. We're still in the abstract phase of this to determine what the potential highest and best use is. But I guess sooner or later there's going to have to be a vote as to whether we do some. We're going through this in Encina for the last decade.
Yeah.
Three times we've looked at it and back and forth, and now we probably have done the right thing by not doing anything, because now we've got a potential study to look at what the right thing is and then what is left that may be able to be done. And then should the decision be made that we do want to do something with it, then it's going to be essential, I believe, on our part, that to get some appraisal value so that if whether it's the city, school district, county, whoever the heck may come when we make the offer a surplus, we have an idea of what that value is.
And if I might add, that may be, and that's certainly up to you, but that may be something you want to think of up front before you declare it surplus. Mm-hmm. Because then once you declare it surplus, this starts the process. I think you want to make informed decisions, and I think the more information that you have, the better you're going to be able to move.
And that's where I was going. So, because we have to have that information at hand because of the time frame to know what to negotiate. So.
And that could be, one other point. That could be confidential. That's not something we have to share with the world. It's something, it's a negotiating issue with the value of that. That's something that you keep confidential.
So a couple things to your point, Director Hernandez. The whole reason why James and his team are studying this is because we did give them consensus that we were interested in learning more about this. I thought that we were going to get kind of more of the what it would take to make it happen and what the potential ROI for the district would be tonight. But if we need to tap into some of their resources to achieve that appraisal process, we really can't. I really like this idea, and if it's something that will net out for our customers and be able to help subsidize water rates in our water district for all of our customers, then I personally would be very supportive of just about anything on this hill, because right now it's not benefiting our customers at all. But I can't even start to even think if I would like to develop this or not until I know that appraisal process. So
What would it take to do that?
Well, that was...
I think that was all part and parcel we were going with this thing, was to have, not necessarily staff, I was looking at outside firms to do it, but staff wanted to do it, so staff did it.
Outside staff did it, yeah.
Well, yeah, we spent $9,000, I wasn't sure, but that we get at least 3 appraisals on the property now, just so we know.
Well, I think what we would want is to come back to you with some proposals of what this is going to, what it potentially the appraisal would cost.
Yes.
And please, what they would, you know, might look at the leasing of the property and these. I think you've got some good information here to go with so that you could say, hey, these are the, with these types of developments, this is what you'd be looking at as if you were going to either sell it or if you wanted to enter into a lease with a potential developer. You could do all that. You know, it's just a question of having those proposals come back to you and having somebody professionally do it that's certified, that we can rely upon, that's that basically has the proper criteria, credentials to do it.
No, I was waiting to have for Jim to finish what he was to say.
I'm done for the moment.
Oh, okay. Well, I was just going to say, I think if we want to move forward, I think council said what we should do is ask for a report back on what would be involved in getting an appraisal. If that's the first step. So that would be my suggestion for the direction. I don't know if it's a motion, but is it or direct? It's a motion.
I don't
I don't mean to pour salt in the wound, but I will here. Is this what happened to the avocado property? They put it off and put it off and kept losing money. And I think that's good, but we have an appraisal on that property that was free by somebody. Or did we pay for to find out what that was worth at $1.2 million 10 years ago?
Well, that all had to do with the water tank up there. And, you know, there was an appraisal done at that time. And then there was a purchase of the property that the board made. And, you know, it was a different circumstance, certainly, than this is. And there, I think it reached a point where the staff looked at it and said, look, this thing is a loser. We need to, you know, a couple of years ago, we need to do something. So they came to you and you said, hey, go get rid of it. And so that's, you know, nobody wanted the property. Certainly the county wasn't going to.
That was just last month. We had the meeting here. We said, get rid of it. It wasn't a couple of years ago.
Well,
when it was authorized to sell.
I mean, when we went through the process with the board, you know, to say, hey, we got to notify these clowns that we want to dump this, get rid of this property, and so we did. We notified the local school district and the county. So,
James, have you sought any estimates on an appraisal for this property?
No, that's really the next step in the process, depending on what the direction of the board is. But this effort here is necessary for the appraisal to go out and look at the prospective uses or the potential uses and the potential values. And I also knew that the getting a certified AIA to go out and do the actual appraisals on a site that is pricey. It's actually going to be probably more than the effort of developing these potentials. So we want to take this step first, knowing that none of this effort is wasted. And since staff didn't have the expertise to do it in-house, just to clarify, we did hire project design consultants who are developers, or development engineers, and they developed this with really minimal direction from staff. The main direction of staff was, we have concerns if we had residents looking over our back fence because we do operate equipment at night and we'd be disturbing residents, inviting complaint calls.
Director Hernandez.
Director Evans, did you make a motion on that?
I was trying to make a motion that we move forward on looking into an appraisal, but you're going to bring us back the information on what that would cost us to pay for an appraisal? Is that what?
Yeah.
I would suggest you get some basic RFPs so you can take a look at what they're going to do and what it would cost.
Then that's my motion. I'd like to move forward in that direction, but I don't want it to be at a big expense in this process.
The clarification?
Yes, sure.
Do you want to second it first? Then we'll have a discussion.
Well, I want a clarification
before,
there should be, in getting the proposals, getting the proposal should be cost nothing.
Yes.
Right.
Very good. So I will second the motion, and let me repeat it so I understand it more clearly. That the motion was to direct staff to to get more than one proposal for an appraisal of the property based on the plans that we have seen and bring it back so that we can hire an appraiser to do the appraisal.
So we can make a decision?
Yes.
Absolutely.
That's, I'll second.
You should have said it all.
Well, I'm just slow
and
well. I got
to okay.
go through.
I just have one question before you vote.
Mm-hmm.
Any chances you put qualified people doing this? We're going to assume.
Oh, it's got to be.
We don't want Sunshine Realty.
It'll be MAI appraisers that do this professionally.
Can you accommodate one more thing? Can you put a timeline on it?
Yeah.
The motion maker?
I don't see the reason for a timeline. I think staff will do what they're told, and I think they'll do it in a timely manner. It's my, I'd rather not.
We can make calls out.
I mean, I you know, we can come back next month. I mean, it's, you know, there's, we can get, the proposals are probably pretty easy to get.
Pretty easy.
We get the message,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right.
Next month.
Next month.
Thank you, Mayor.
Need to vote? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Direction given.
Thanks, James.
Thank you, James. Good job. Good information.
See you next month.
He was about to say 2 months.
I heard a month. That's right.
Month is, month is a good
month. But is it a 30-day month or a 31-day month?
Next month is 7 weeks.
Let's just see if we see it next month.
Yeah, 7 weeks.
7 weeks? What do you mean?
He's smart. He knew to say next month.
Okay. Next month item 2.4.
No, any time in November.
Tom, I'll turn it over to you. Ordinance establishing raised rules and regulations. Okay. Hey, guys.
I'm sorry.
November 1st.
Doing more work?
I heard November 1st.
No, I didn't hear that.
Okay, thank you, President Snell. On page 135 of your packet, you'd have a staff report, which is followed by a struck-out ordinance and then a final ordinance. And this was for the action taken at the last regular board meeting to pass through half the wholesale increase on commodity. No other changes. So this is just the ordinance that records that action. And just for your reference, on the bottom of page 135, kind of like the before and after to show you what the impact is to the rate. So, and it was just a commodity, so that's what it's showing you over here at the bottom. What it is now is that table on top, and then what it is, how it's reflected in the ordinance, is the second table towards the bottom.
Okay.
So with that, if there's any questions, I'd be glad to answer them, but the staff recommends adoption of the ordinance.
Any questions or discussion?
Just because I know one of the former speakers was concerned that of his mobile home park, so I just want to be clear to the viewers at home that at tier one we're actually paying some of your water bill because we are not passing along that pass through.
Correct. It's tier
and
one was supposed
if,
to be
if all
the
those,
wholesale rate.
Conservative ratepayers are using less water and maintained in tier one. You've got a couple of 50-cent benefit. Only when you get to tier two, three, and four are we finally catching up and making the numbers work. And so, and that was all we did.
Correct.
Okay.
And I wanted to clarify for the people who were here before also that we did not change the rate structures, so those who are in the 1-inch meters remain on the same tiers
good
as
point.
Prior. I know that was a concern for 4 or 5 of the people.
Correct. That's correct.
Move for approval.
Okay. We have to make some kind of.
Is there a second?
Yes.
Okay. Can we have a roll call vote, please, Diane?
Yes.
Director Evans?
Yes.
Director Hernandez?
Yes.
Director
Martin?
Yeah.
Director Snow? No. Motion passes 4-1. Okay, reports. Anything?
If that's okay with you, I'd like to have James come up if you still can't. James has a report. He's been attending the coalition meetings for the water recycling. And got some information on some grant opportunities and just kind of an update about what that's been going on.
Thank you, President Snell, members of the board. As the board is aware that the Vallecitos has been part of the North County Water Reuse Coalition, I think I got that right, which is now the shorter name than we're used to. Yeah. And we've completed the feasibility study. Matter of fact, we've completed the feasibility study three times because as the federal and state laws and rules have changed, we've had to update the feasibility study. The environmental document was adopted without challenge, and we've actually turned in the feasibility study to Dennis Wolf at the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation as a courtesy, a draft copy up front. We turned it into him a couple Thursdays ago, and on Monday he called back and said it looks complete already, so no additional edits required. And if and when the U.S. Bureau gets grant money, we are already in line. So that's the good news. The bad news is WARDA, which is the Army Corps Engineer bill going through the House and the Senate. And I guess this is good and bad news, has passed. The Senate has passed a version, the House has passed a version of it. There's some reconciliation of those two different versions, which the Senate and the House has stated that they are minor and they're not contradictory. However, no recycled or water reuse projects were added in. They're excluded. So during the reconciliation period, the Furman Group, which is the lobbyist, is going to try and get some of the language in. But right now, it's pretty much looks like the water bill is going to pass at this moment with no recycled water and water reuse or any money for those projects included in that. So that's kind of the bad news there. So those are the main items. If there's any questions on the coalition or the coalition activities, I'd be happy to answer questions.
Thanks, James.
John.
That's all I had for my report.
I have no report.
And Sandag has not met yet, so nothing there. I mean San Diego County Water Authority. Neither has Sandag, so that's convenient.
Okay, good. And did you meet?
The Policy and Finance Committee hasn't met since our last meeting. We meet next Tuesday.
Capital Committee hasn't met. We're going to meet in the next week or two. I don't remember the exact date.
Good. Any director's reports on travel, conferences, or seminars?
Yes. Go ahead.
At Director Hernandez's suggestion, I took a trip along with two of the other board members and went down to see Santee Lakes in their reclamation center, which was very interesting. It's 1/10 the size of Pure Water. They've been doing reclamation now for 50 to 60 years. I didn't realize that all the lakes down there are actually recycled water, which is very good. And they've made it into a very nice benefit to the community over all those years with the lakes. They have water sports, non-contact, but you have boating, you have cabins. They make most amount of their revenue in RV rental spaces and covered RV spaces, which the water district owns and operates completely. And it was reported they take in mostly run by volunteers, although I think they have eight full-timers.
Yes.
Volunteers, and they take in $5 million a year, and they spend about $4 million a year, so that's about $1 million a year. And they take that money and put it back into the district, not taking anything out of it. So both were very interesting, and I enjoyed that. Also, I had met with two of our applicants during that time period, which I turned in a thing to our applicant one morning for 2.5 hours here in town, and the other applicant 3 hours up in Temecula. So I have put in for per diem on that. That's my report. And I guess we have to take a vote on that.
Yes.
Well, it'll be on the next agenda. We'll agendize it for reimbursement.
Okay.
The I too attended the Santee Lakes event, and perhaps we should turn our acreage into an RV park because they're making boo-boo bucks on that.
I'm open-minded.
Yeah, just knocking down on that whole thing, and 50 years in the making. Okay, you got to start somewhere. So anyway, we'll get there. And then
Let's see, what else? I think we went to the Water Council, didn't we? No, maybe I don't. Different time, okay. I think that was, in future agenda, director's comments on future agenda?
We're not there yet.
That's director's reports, sorry.
I attended the same tour, found it very informative, and on the advanced water purification, the demonstration project, it's a 100,000 gallon per day demonstration they're looking to do with several East County agencies, I think up to 20 MGD of wastewater treatment with full tertiary treatment with advanced treatment beyond that in order to do indirect potable reuse to put that water into Lake Jennings as the forebay for water treatment. So very interesting project.
Dr. Abbott, do you have any
comments? No, I did not.
Yep. I did not travel or go to any conferences either. So we'll move on to 4.1. There's a WEF river restoration tour coming up, so let Diane know if you haven't already, if you're going to attend that. And then now, Director Hernandez, 5.1. Any future agenda items or director's comments?
Yes, a couple. I think we're going to have a new GM here sometime soon. I would like to put on a future agenda in the not too distant future that we start the 218 for next year. This is going to bite us in the backside, this pass through that didn't take place, and so I'd like that to start, and I guess putting on the agenda to agree to do that is one thing. Second thing is, I think I would like us to look, and I don't know if it's two separate items or one, relative to the 1-inch water meter issue and our charges for that, and two, the power charges, or if that's all wrapped into the 218. But we need to look at those more specifically so that we can make some determination as to what we want to do.
If you're looking for consensus, I don't agree with that. One director's opinion. I think we just went through the 218 process that all five of us had the opportunity to evaluate it and could have supported and voted for staff's recommendation through that process. And for whatever reason, they chose not to. So to just start it over again a couple weeks later doesn't make sense to me. So I'll throw that out there. If there's two others, then that's fine, but.
I think it would be fine to put it on an agenda to look at where we're going. We've only completed our budget basically until January, so it's only 2 months. I definitely would like us to take into consideration the 1-inch water meter charges and how we need to handle that, and if we were a bit premature on our first decisions. And I know the power charges are separate from the 218s, but we usually do it at that time. So I think maybe those are separate, not all at once, but they're very worthy of looking at too and reconsidering, and just gaining some knowledge on it. It's not the process of the 218 I'm concerned with. I think it's more just to take a look at where we're going to go when we are already approved a rate increase that's putting us at $5 million out of our reserves within a year. I think that's our fiduciary responsibility.
Director Martin.
I'd like for us all to have the opportunity to discuss with our new GM how quickly he thinks it's feasible. He's got to get his feet wet and learn a lot of things. So when you say future agenda item, I don't disagree, it should be future agenda item, but I'd like to have a conversation with him and see what he believes is practical. He's got to get his feet on the ground, and at the same time, I'm going to come back to the next meeting, put together a budget. And we were challenged at the last meeting by Director Hernandez that the budget, the finance guys aren't meeting as much as they should. And so I'm going to discuss with President Sanella when we should have the next one and schedule that as quickly as possible. And I would also like our council to look into the way we conduct ourselves at committee meetings. Our committee meetings, opposite of meetings of the whole, which in my opinion were a huge Brown Act violation, these committee meetings where there's only two voting people there do not have to have a recording secretary, do not have to have the staff and to keep notes But I'm just saying, to save budgetary money, you have to have a recording secretary. It doesn't have to be open to the public, my understanding. Now, I'd like you to come back and tell me I'm wrong and show me where in the Brown Act that tells me I'm wrong. When any of the committee meetings are made up of two members of the board and whoever, but they're not public meetings.
Well, that used to be the law.
Did it change?
But they changed the law that when you have what they call standing committees, okay? If it's a standing committee, which is a committee that meets basically on a routine basis and is an ongoing committee, those have to be noticed and the Brown Act provisions have to be followed.
Okay, thank you.
But there is a provision, you're right, they do allow under the Brown Act for if it's a special committee that has a specific task for that has a if you will say minimal duration, then they can form an ad hoc committee. The president has the power to appoint two members to that ad hoc committee, and they can meet and they don't have to comply with the Brown Act, okay? But as far as as long as there's somebody there, you can have minutes, you know, somebody can take a minute of the meetings. It doesn't necessarily have to be the staff, you know?
Well, our meetings in the finance committee, although we call them standing and we appoint people to it,
yeah,
we had like three last year, the entire year. So they weren't necessarily
right routine
all
meetings
all the time. But I plan personally on working to get new ones to have those, because we're not getting a lot done because we don't have the meeting of the whole. We don't have our committees, and granted, our old GM, not this one, the old GM really didn't want to have committee meetings. So it was always difficult to have them, and I think they're an important part of what we do. We need to have them to get together. And again, being challenged by Director Hernandez at the last one made me say, you know, we're right, we should be delving into this more than we have. We should have delved into the budget a lot more than we did at those meetings. And really question staff on a lot of things that you never did. So I take the blame for that, but I think in the future we need to do that. So I'll be coming up at the next meeting with a date after I talk to Mr. Sinella about when we can do it. And we can have it at 5:00 at night. I don't care, it doesn't bother me.
Did you remember?
Well, yes, I did. I have two concerns about the committees, to be honest. I feel that actually Dennis Lamb did want the committee meetings, and it kind of encouraged us to maintain that on our ordinance, even though many years, the last couple of years, the boards had met as a special meeting as a whole. And I know there's supposed to be an efficiency in the committee meetings, but I'm very glad to hear that there's minutes, and I would prefer that there were staff and recordings, because one of the challenges that we made when we came on in 2013 was we felt that those meetings were behind closed doors. Well, I feel like the committee meetings are behind closed doors if they're not willing to be recorded. I think that that's important, and it's really only way for I to know what really happened in the meetings, because you know one of the minutes was you asked about landscape people, you were told there were two, and it was like a 12-minute meeting, it was over, and that didn't tell me anything. I also have a concern that I want to be a part of those decisions when it comes to finance. I don't feel that, personally, that my thoughts are being represented by the committee. And I know we've had a couple of times where we wanted to have a committee, it was either all of us are only two people that would agree to be in it. They didn't want anyone else. So I'm just saying that I would like us as a group to discuss our ordinance and consider, are standing committees the way to go, or is it just fair that we present these issues as a board to the board as a whole? I think it's important we're all involved, and I don't feel that I have been represented for my part of the constituency. And that isn't just on finance.
Director Martin.
I must tell you, we haven't had, since the meeting of the whole was dissolved, because some of us found it objectionable, that was dissolved, it was kind of like in your face, we won't have meetings, because I've tried to put together some meetings, and I was told by the former GM, just, you know, we don't need a meeting. So it's like, okay. So I bowed to that. If there's a secretary there, that's great. If you want the attorney there, that's great. I was just thinking of that as cost savings. Well, it's going to take minutes, that's great. But at a committee meeting, absolutely no decisions are made. You have the committee talking with staff, and decisions get made at the boardroom, not in a back room. So I don't know what you're talking about. Because you'd have the opportunity
to talk about it. I'm saying anytime we have meetings that they're not recorded, I feel the public is being cheated out of the opportunity to hear it on our, I am so sorry, very uninteresting, hard to hear, hard to visualize, televised meetings. But I, that's just my personal belief that it should be that way. I'm not implying you did it behind closed doors. I'm simply saying that I would like to have it recorded. And I think that that's important for the public, and there are important meetings, especially if it's finance. You know, when you have these committees, that's part of the thing. They're focused on a very narrow thing. So in that sense, that's where I believe that's important. But I think some of the decisions, particularly on auditing, or a lot of the information on, I believe it was, engineering maybe, that was looking into the lift, your project, Jim, with the refill station. Well, you know, I know you guys got to get a lot of information, that's to save it, but I, after reading what was there, I thought, well, to make a real decision on the board, I would have wanted to kind of had all those presentations done again to the whole board. All of us have a chance to go to see the site. So to me, it seems it would be much more efficient not to have a separate meeting and then have another one to us to make the decision. So I'm just, and all I'm saying is, could we please bring it forward as a discussion of how we want to proceed before now? And most of these decisions, really, I think Hal was right on his comments regarding your suggestion looking into 218 and the metering and that. I think we need to wait till we have our GM. And maybe he has an entirely different idea of how he'd like it done. So to me, between now and till the new GM is here, it might just be pertinent to, and prudent to wait. My comments.
Fred Hernandez.
I just wanted, and that's why I said future. I mean, it doesn't have to be next week or next month, but I really do think we need to review that with the new GM so that we know where we're going. A. B, relative, and I was the one that challenged the president and finance committee that if they're concerned about, and we're all concerned about the budget, but if they want to delve into it, it needs to be delved into more than up here talking about it. And then brought back, and if there's recorded minutes and all that, we'll still have a chance at the meeting to delve into potentially other areas that may not have been discussed. What I wanted to ask the committee to think about is perhaps expanding the committee to bring in some selected public members to discuss this, to see that, so that our ratepayers know that we're not just, you know, favoring some of our issues and putting off to be hacked up somebody else's issues. That I would leave that up to the committee to discuss and see if that makes any practical sense. But that's all I got to say for the moment.
So finishing my conversation, the next meeting I'll be bringing forward a date. Mr. Snow will get along with the finance committee and talk about some budgetary cuts.
Any other board member comments? I have one. Jeff, as a relatively new board member, I was a little bit taken aback tonight when one of our colleagues had to recuse themselves for, is that just simply because this matter was in her district? Or can you kind of give us a little overview of why board members might have to recuse themselves?
Well, under the Fair Political Praxis Act, there is a provision in there that if the matter is coming forward to you as a public official to make a decision on, if there's a potential that the matter may have a financial effect on your property, then you have to consider recusing yourself because of those potential conflicts. And the problem is that there in this area, there's going to be some fairly significant improvements. There's going to be traffic light improvements. There's going to be road improvements. There may be some infrastructure improvements that will potentially affect the market value of a person's property or residence. And what that was brought forward in a letter to the director, and was, and basically you've got a difficult choice. I personally think that ultimately the FBPC in this case will rule that this is not a conflict of interest. But the problem is it doesn't matter what I think. It matters what they think, because they're the prosecuting authority. And it's been my experience that sometimes they can be pretty rough on these things, and things that don't necessarily look to be that significant can turn out to be, we're seeing more and more that to be serious consequences. And so purely out of abundance of caution, when asked what to do, is to seek guidance from the FBPC. And we have a letter ready to go to the FBPC outlining the issue and requesting guidance and opinion, so that as we go through this process, it very likely will be, if Director Evans is on the board, that this issue may come up. We have development agreements that come forward. There's numerous things that will come forward if this project proceeds. And we need to find out if there's a problem, and if there is, then that director needs to recuse themselves in participating or voting on the matter. So that's basically the drill. And I'm conservative when it comes to these things, because the FBPC can be kind of nasty about it. And I think there's been a number of occasions when each of you sought advice, and we've basically done the same thing.
No, I appreciate that, and it's a good, okay. Just kind of a good little refresher on that whole process, because we all live in our districts, right? And so if there's a project that's going to be built in our area, we can kind of plan accordingly for that, that process. So thank you, Director Martin.
Any more issues? Can I bring up something else?
Sure.
Is it comments? Comment yep. Time. Okay, great comment time. I'm going to do this how finance does it, so it's going to be interesting to me. Does the district own a Harley Davidson? Is that one of our vehicles?
No.
No. If one of our vehicles had a Harley Davidson in the back of it, would we assume that something's wrong? Or would we assume we moved out of the way of a water main break? What do you think?
Yeah, we would look into that, certainly.
I would give it to you to look into it, because I was at a function the other night where husband and wife and adult daughter, 25, all said to me, "Hey, what's your truck doing with a Harley Davidson? It was really nice Harley Davidson. It was in the back of a pickup truck that purely had your name on the side of it." And I went, "I don't know. We don't do that for personal stuff. You never catch a board member doing that." And I did ask, and we do have the specific in our handbook, violation of using anything for your own public good. Now my question is, we also have a vehicle that the on-duty person drives, correct?
Yeah, we have a few on.
And we let them drive that. I'm just saying, because it came up during the interview process, we were talking about giving the new GM a car or not. If we gave him a vehicle, the problems you get into with that, because you have insurance problems and you have all types of problems. So I understand the person that's off duty, but does that mean if they have to pick their son up at school, they can use it? I don't know. But because they're always on the call? I don't know. It could be like a fireman. I don't know. I'm asking.
Duty people are required to use their duty truck no matter what when they're on duty, because to minimize that response time. So they have to respond immediately.
And we have one duty person on at all times.
We have multiple duty people. We have a construction duty, we have duty for the treatment plant, and we have collections duty. So we'll have three. Did I miss one? War ops, I'm sorry. We have four. Water ops, collections, construction, and the treatment plant. So we have four on-duty vehicles all the time, and they're actually required to use them all the time, and that includes personal.
Okay. And all four of those vehicles, or however many we have that are passenger vehicles, are they clearly marked?
Yes, they're Vallecitos, with the Vallecitos logo.
All of our vehicles are?
Correct.
Except the Harley. Thank you very much. I'll get back to you in private.
Any other comments?
Just to clarify, the two things that I have coming back are because the Padre Dam was not on a list of, so that'll come back to you to approve per diem for that, and that's at the next meeting. And also, as Director Martin mentioned, for the interviews that he conducted, to request that per diem and reimbursement. We'll come back to you for approval. We'll put that on the next agenda.
For consideration?
Correct.
Yeah. Right. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Hold on.
We got a closed session.
Adjourn. We're going to be
do we have a closed session?
Are we going to close session?
Okay, is there a motion to go to closed session?
On the thing.
Do we need it?
Yeah, but I mean, it's been there for
Do we need it?
Do we have something
yes.
to talk about?
Oh, yes, okay. We do. Yes.
We do.
Okay. Very quickly, yes,
okay.
We do.
Can we get a motion to go to closed session?
So moved. Second.
All right. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.